Der Herr ist mein Licht und mein Heil. Wen soll ich fürchten?
Le déroulement de tes paroles est clair.
Wewe Bwana, tata yangu, ya moto, Mungu wanga anarusa giza langu kuwa mwanga.
Light dawns in the darkness for the upright. He is gracious, merciful and righteous.
Jedes gute, vollkommene Geschenk kommt von oben, vom unserer Vater der Lichte.
Vieni, camminiamo nella luce del Signore.
Staan op, word verlig, want jou lig het gekom, en die heerlijkheid van die Heere gaan oor jou op.
Tieni, ti chosen chito zandima, di kuvala zida zakuwala.
Nuru inangaza gizani, na giza hajali.
Je suis venu dans le monde sous forme de lumière, afin que quiconque croit en moi ne reste pas dans les ténèbres.
Good morning. A warm welcome to Common Ground Blaubeek. We are going to start our time with a moment of worship. Can I ask that you be on your feet and let us worship God together?
Thank you.
like to continue to worship God together, but I just want to take a moment to extend a welcome for some of you who are joining us for the very first time this morning. We are so delighted that you could be with us. Just a few things for you to know. The bathrooms are right out through those doors to my left, and through the same doors when we finish this meeting, we'd love for you to join us for a cup of coffee or tea. And in this moment, I'm reminded there is a story in the Bible of two sisters, and Jesus goes to visit this family, and the one sister gets preoccupied with all the stuff that needed to be done, whereas the one sister focuses and presences herself with Jesus. I just get a sense that God would want to invite us to presence ourselves to Him. He is present, but He's asking, won't you be present with me? Won't you be present to all that I am for you this morning? He's inviting us to the joy of being present before Him. Maybe for some of us, the preoccupation is with, how am I going to provide for my family? How am I going to meet pressing needs? And there is a God who delights in doing good to us, calling you, be present with me. I am the same God who feeds the birds, who clothes the lilies in the field. Come, be present with me. Maybe there's a preoccupation with guilt of things that you've done in the week, or maybe guilt of stuff you've done in the past. There is a God who forgives all sins, whose Son has died once and for all time, and He's calling you, be present with me and enjoy the joy of being forgiven, of being set free. Why don't we present ourselves wherever you are this morning as we worship God this morning? Father, we come before you. We pause to be still. We center our scattered thoughts into your presence, O Lord God. And we give our hearts to you, O God, who delights to be present to us. Amen. Let us sing together.
Praise Him, all your creatures, great and small. Praise Him, summer, winter, spring, and fall. Howling wind, rushing streams, rolling hills, and crashing seas. Lift your voice and worship your Creator. Praising gleaming moon and burning sun. Praise Him, all your spinning spheres above. Shining stars, golden wings, choir made of galaxies. Lift your voice and worship your Creator. Come on, church, let's lift this up together. Holy, you are holy.
You're worthy of it all. sing, hear your people sing. To the King of Kings, you will always be. Sing your name. Church, can we do something this morning? If you're comfortable to lift your hands to the one who is sitting on the throne of your lives. We can lift our hands to so many things, but Jesus is our King this morning. So if you're comfortable, won't you raise your hands and just say, Lord, there's no other name that is higher in my life. It's a sign of surrender. It's a sign to say, Jesus, I place you on the throne. You're my first love. There's no other name that is higher than the name of Jesus. Come, we're going to sing your name, every voice. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name is the highest. All thrones, all powers. It's your name. Sing your name. Your name. Church, we say it out. Hear your people say.
Father, what a privilege for us to sing to the praise of your holy name. What an honor for us to sing to the excellences of your wonderful name. God, as we lift our hands in surrender, we say, God, we do it freely. We do it lovingly. Do it with humility to you who gave everything for us. God, I think of how all of us were like the prodigal son as we meandered looking and approaching you, thinking of the best story to tell to you. Yet, you choose to run towards us with love. You choose to place a robe to cover all our sins. And you put a ring on our finger and affirm that we are yours and yours forever. We thank you, God, for all that you have done for us, and we surrender to your love again and again and again as we lift our hands to you, Almighty God. full of love and mercy, full of compassion and kindness. What a wonderful God you are. And what a wonderful mystery that we are yours and yours forever. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, God. Amen. We are going to release the kids as they go to Kids Rock. I want to ask for the rest of us, please remain standing. And if you could take a moment to greet somebody next to you that you haven't said hello to. What an amazing, amazing time worshiping God together. For parents with little ones, just a reminder that we've got two dedicated spaces for you to take your little ones to. So if your child is a year and younger, there is a place across the foyer to my right. There's an audio feed there, please, and a video feed. Wow, so you can really keep up with what's happening here. So you're welcome to take your kids there. And for those with kids that are a year and above, there is another place across the quad. And there is Jess there who's more than happy to help you hold the baby and relieve you in that sense. And there is coffee and tea in there. And for those of you who are visiting us for the very first time, would really love to connect with you. And there are a couple of ways that you can connect with us and get to keep up with what's happening in the life of this church. So we've got a WhatsApp group, and the number is right on the screen. You can just send an emoji, and we'll gladly add you to that WhatsApp group. We also have presence on Facebook and Instagram, so you can also connect through those channels. Most of you who were here last week, you recall that we sent out a clarion call asking that if you could please give a special offering towards a collection that we are putting together to support churches through our network of relationship called Advance that are under-resourced. And as a church, we had said we would give 100,000 out of our mercy fund, and there was a gap of 20,000. I'm glad to report back to you that by God's generosity that overflowed from him to you and from you to us, we managed to raise 30,800 rand. So thank you. Thank you so much for your generosity. And if you're hearing this and perhaps you are not a regular giver and you're thinking to yourself, man, I want to participate in this. Our banking details are up on the screen. Please use that reference, BBRCG. And now to some exciting things that we can look forward to. So firstly, we've got a moment or an extended moment of prayer and worship that's happening on Tuesday, the 14th of May. Please stick that or diarize that date. And you might be asking, so who gets to go to an extended time of worship and prayer? Well, everybody. It's really just a relaxed time, pressure-free time of us just coming before God and worshiping him and praying and seeking God's guidance for us as a community. So you are all welcome. We will be meeting here in this auditorium. We'll be starting sharp at 6:30.
and we aim to be done by 7:45. So it's a good time to end for those who might be worried about the next day, preparing for work or preparing kids to go to school. And we also have Top Gen that are meeting for a social over soup and a roll this morning after church. I'm told it's not too late to sign up if you haven't signed up already. So if you want to connect with the rest of Top Gen, please be available in the coffee and tea area at 11:30, and you will be able to enjoy some warm soup and a roll. Just a moment. Then you probably would have received a WhatsApp, if you're on the WhatsApp group, that we have done our year review of 2023. And with that, we have put up a presentation which essentially captures God's faithful towards us as a community in numbers. So there is financial numbers there, but there's also other non-financial numbers. If you have received the PDF and you prefer to read the PDF, good. But if you prefer to read a hard copy, there will be a hard copy available for the next couple of weeks in our guest area. So please go there and make use of that hard copy. Just don't take it home. It's that time again of the year where we get to look into our closets and look at maybe blankets or clothes that we do not need. I'm sure most of us agree that for a number of us, we have more than we need. So this is an opportunity for us to love those of us who might be facing the winter in Cape Town without a warm blanket or warm clothes. So I want to encourage you that as you go home, to please prayerfully and generously consider as you go through your closets and gather clothing, stuff, and blankets. Please make sure that they are clean when you bring them on the 26th of May. So we will be doing a collection here at church on the 26th of May. And with that, I am going to call up Bianca to do a Bible reading as Andy prepares to preach.
Hi, everyone. So I'm Bianca. I'll be reading from 1 Samuel chapter 16, verses 1 through to 13. Samuel anoints David. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you mourn for Saul, since I've rejected him as king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I'm sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem. I've chosen one of his sons to be king." But Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears about it, he will kill me." The Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I've come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice and I'll show you what to do. You are to anoint for me the one I indicate." Samuel did what the Lord said. When he arrived at Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when they met him. They asked, "Do you come in peace?" Samuel replied, "Yes, in peace. I've come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come to the sacrifice with me." Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they arrived, Samuel saw Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and had him pass in front of Samuel. But Samuel said, "The Lord has not chosen this one either." Jesse had then had Shammah pass by, but Samuel said, "Nor has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse had seven of his sons pass before Samuel, but Samuel said to him, "The Lord has not chosen these." So he asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons you have?" "They're still the youngest," Jesse answered. "He is tending to the sheep." Samuel said, "Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives." So he sent for him and had him brought in. He was glowing with health and had a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, "Rise and anoint him. This is the one." So Samuel took the horn of the oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. Samuel then went to Ramah.
From that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. What an amazing way to set the scene for the story of David. And we remember David as a mighty warrior, as a great king, and probably the greatest songwriter in the history of God's people. And all of that is set up, it's foreshadowed in that one line. The Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. But all of that takes place after, and our passage takes place before. We arrive in the story to a David who is much less extraordinary than the one that we remember later on. In his ordinariness, we learn something about David, we learn something about Jesus, and we learn something about ourselves as well. So David is an important character in the narrative arc of Scripture. If you look at the Bible as a whole and the story that God tells, David is a key character to understand. He's the culmination of many of the threads of the Old Testament. Much of the journey of God's people from the start kind of reaches some form of a climax in David. But at the same time, he's just the prototype on which the messianic hopes of God's people would come to rest. He's just like version one, not really the end product. He's like an example. So God's promise to raise up a king from the line of David would be fulfilled later in Jesus, which makes David a unique case study to learn more about who Jesus is and the promises that he fulfills. And because of David's unique importance, we get multiple introductions to him. I love this, right? If you've watched movies, anybody here watch movies? Some of us do. Less nowadays. Now we stream series instead. But when you watch television of various forms, they often do this thing of like flashbacks, right? As you go through the life of an important character, you'll get that one episode that like takes place way before, and it's like just a snapshot into who is this person. And then another episode, another time, they'll flash back to a whole different story, and you'll learn something else about your character. And Samuel, who most scholars think Samuel probably wrote 1 Samuel, makes sense. He takes us into David's story with like a number of introductions. Like he tried one and he's like, but maybe that's not all the introducing. So I'll introduce him another way and I'll introduce him another way. So there's this passage, is one introduction to David. And we're going to look at another one next week. And there's actually another one that we're not even going to look at. If you want to read it, it's in chapter 13, the rest of chapter 13. It's like a different intro to David. Like intros David like this, like this, like this. Just make sure we have all of the angles covered. Okay. But it's because David's important. It's because David has so much to teach us. And the threads of David's character that are illuminated in today's passage will play a key role in making sense of his behavior in the rest of his story. So we're going to be looking at the life of David for the next 3-ish months or so. If that sounds long, don't worry. There's a lot of diversity in his life. He's like did a lot of interesting things. But we've got to start with a clear grounding in who David was before he became king. We want to know who is David at the core. Who is David? So let's get started. Verse 10, Jesse had 7 of his sons pass before Samuel. But Samuel said to him, "The Lord has not chosen these." So he asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons you have?" "There is still the youngest," Jesse answered. "He is tending the sheep." Let's recap some of the backstory of this, right? Israel wanted a king. Samuel anointed Saul as the king. Saul went through a series of disobediences and turning away from God till eventually God said to Saul, "I've rejected you as king." And now he says to Samuel, "Go and anoint a new king." Samuel says, it's amazing, if you look at the beginning of the passage, he says, "I can't do it. If Saul hears about it, he'll kill me." Saul had so turned away from following God that he's like going to protect his throne by any means necessary. But God says, just have the sacrifice. Invite Jesse and his sons to the sacrifice. So Samuel invites them. Now, David was a son of Jesse. So he was invited to the sacrifice, right? He was invited, but he was also not invited because he was the youngest. And all the sons of Jesse were invited, but David didn't presume to show up. And apparently his family didn't think that Samuel would want him there either. So they left him to watch the sheep, right? Are these all the sons you have? Well, one more, but you wouldn't want to see him. And David didn't abandon his duty. He wasn't like the spirited Disney hero, right? He's like not invited, but they sneak in. They find a way to get in because they just have to be at the center of the action. David's like, yeah,
I'll watch the sheep. You guys go, bros. Go to the party. You know? In a word, then, David was humble. Humble. He was the youngest, and at risk of reading too much into scripture, is being the youngest not often a place of humility? I'm the oldest. But my youngest brother's sitting here. You can ask him afterwards whether he's humble or not. But if he says yes, is that true or untrue? Like Moses who wrote about Moses, that he was the most humble man. But the youngest, in a sense, is a place of humility. The youngest is not the first to inherit. He's not the first to be invited to speak up and have an opinion. By the time that the youngest is old enough to start having opinions, the others have much stronger opinions. And it's like, be quiet. We don't need to hear what you have to say. The youngest was pushed around, made useful, kind of expected to stay out of the way, keep your head down. Maybe David grew up like this. 7 older brothers. Wow. And of course, it can go 2 ways, right? We have in the Bible the story of Joseph, who was also the youngest, and he became so obnoxious that his brothers sold him into slavery. I think maybe David knew this story. So it seems that David learned humility and to make the best of his lot. The humility of David is clearly highlighted in that he doesn't put himself forward to be the king. He's out there doing his duty. He doesn't seem to think much of himself after he's anointed either. At the end of this passage, Samuel anoints David. Then Samuel goes to Ramah. And do you know where David went? Not to the palace. He went back to the sheep. He's like, okay, I'm still David. He was humble. It's an interesting way that Samuel wants to set up the story of David, because he's contrasting David strongly to Saul, right? Saul is the king on the way out. What is Saul doing? Saul, in the previous passage, if you were here last week, Saul starts off the passage by setting up a monument to himself, right? Saul, at the beginning of this passage, Samuel says, if Saul hears about it, he will kill me. Saul was out for Saul's benefit. Saul was out to look after Saul. And Samuel sets up this contrast. Look at the king that God is choosing to replace Saul. He's not like Saul. He's humble. The thread of humility in David's life is a definitive one. We need to remember this. For 3 months, you need to remember David is humble. Okay? Because what David does through the next passages we're going to study in the coming weeks shows his humility, and it's born out of that humility. And a lot of what we learn through David's story is how God rewards humility. Scripture says the Lord opposes the proud but shows favor to the humble. Secondly, in verse 11, Samuel said, "Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives." So he sent for him and had him brought in. He was glowing with health and had a fine appearance and handsome features. There's this saying that God does not call the equipped, he equips the called. Have you heard that before? It's a nice saying. There's some value in it, but it's not the whole truth. The truth is, I think, somewhere in the middle. God does tend to select suitable servants for his strategies. Or perhaps it could be said like this, that while God certainly does equip the called, often the equipping happens a long time before the calling. Yeah? Verse 7, it says, the Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. David was selected primarily for his heart, but that doesn't mean he was selected in ignorance of his other attributes, right? God chose David as a suitable king. He had many characteristics that qualified him to be a leader of God's people. This is important to remember. We talk about David's humility, but humility is not the same as unsuitability, weakness, or He was suitable. He was humble. He was also hardworking. We learn in the story he was fulfilling his duties, looking after the sheep. We'll learn more about that too. He speaks about it at other times. He was also, interestingly enough, the Bible doesn't say this, but I know it's true and I'll explain it to you. He was investing in his God-given talents. The next story, the one we're not going to look at, David is called to be a musician in Saul's court. Because David, it turns out, was a gifted musician. That doesn't happen by accident. Hands up who was born a gifted musician. No, you have to put in the work. David in all his younger brotherness, was quietly going about his business, becoming the best musician in the history of God's people. He was investing in the talents that God had given him. He was hardworking and diligent. We see this about David. Cool. Okay. He was obedient and faithful. One of the themes of David's story is the way that he listens to the voice of God, but we also see how he listens to the voice of his father in this story. In the story of David and Goliath that we'll see next week, it starts off with David's father sending David to go and visit his brothers in the army, and David goes. He's obedient and faithful. He does what is asked of him. He does what Samuel asks of him as the prophet. He obeys God's prophet. David was strong, but he was also gentle. He was a shepherd. Now, we picture beautiful idyllic scenes of like sheep, you know, in the green grass, and just it's a beautiful like pasture scene. Sometimes that's the case with sheep. But sometimes a sheep gets its head stuck in the fence and you have to like rip it out of that fence, right? Sometimes there's a wolf coming to get the sheep and you have to fight off the wolf. David spoke of fighting off lions and bears. He said when a lion or a bear came and stole one of the flock, he went and he delivered his sheep. This guy was strong, but he was gentle as well. These implications are important. This is what you want in a king. This is what you want in a leader. You want someone who's able to make tough choices, to do what's right, to stand for the truth. But you want someone who's gentle, who's merciful, who's able to look after the weak, who doesn't trample on the needs of others, but cares about those that he's looking after. David was a suitable king. He had the heart of a worshiper. We learn early of his music, and only later that we learn about the heart of worship. But the Psalms, so many of the Psalms were written by David, these beautiful songs of God's people that the church has been singing for 2,000 years. The Psalms that David wrote were born out of a heart that was in love with God. He had the heart of a worshiper. David was a suitable king. God didn't choose him for his attributes, but he didn't choose him in spite of his attributes. God had prepared a man to be the king for his people. Verse 13, so Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. Samuel then went to Ramah. When you think of a great leader, what characteristics do you think of? Do you think of their tallness, their intelligence, their charisma, quick thinking, wise, patient? How far do we make it down the list of attributes, though, before we reach spirit-empowered? David's capability was two parts, right? He had good abilities. He was suitable. But most importantly, he was filled with the Spirit. The reason David was not just suitable but capable of being the leader of God's people is that he was filled with the Spirit. I've read this verse already. Verse 7, people look at the outward appearance. The Lord looks at the heart. The secret to David's success wasn't his suitability. It wasn't his strength or his genius or his way with people. He had those things, but they weren't the secret. They weren't even secret. The secret was no secret at all. The Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David. And if we want to understand the life of David, if we want to be set up for this next 3 months journey, we need to get this clear, that David didn't beat Goliath with a trick, the Lord helped him. That David didn't become king by luck, the Lord helped him. David didn't lead the nation or write the Psalms or conquer his enemies or prosper Israel by his own brilliance. Say it with me, the Lord helped him. Right? The capability of David to rule was given to him by God. God poured out his Spirit on David and transformed his potential, his suitability, into reality, into capability. Without the Spirit's help, David was like a great guy who looked like he might be useful one day. But with the Spirit, he was a mighty man of God. And there's a twofold role that the Spirit played in David's life. There was empowering, yes, but there was relationship. The Spirit helped David in his doings, but much more, he helped David in his being. Humility comes from the Spirit. Repentance comes from the Spirit. David was not perfect. He made some howlers. He messed up big time, right? The difference between David and Saul wasn't like the mistakes that they made. Someone said this at yeah, during the week they mentioned, like, David made way worse mistakes than Saul. Like, we'll get into it later. What's the difference? The difference is when Saul made a mistake, he tried to blame someone else. He tried to pass it off as the right thing to do. He tried to justify himself. When David made a mistake, he turned and repented with weeping and with seeking God and saying, God, I'm so sorry for my hard heart. Help me. I repent. The repentance is a gift of the Holy Spirit. Stay close to God. He will help you turn from wrong and do right. So the people of God need leaders who are capable, not capable of leading, first of all. The first thing that qualifies you to be a leader in God's family is not that you're a good leader. That's like at the bottom of the list. It's nice, it's important, you need to be suitable, but you need the Spirit first. You need someone who is capable of walking the long, slow, obedient road of humble relationship with God. So exploring who David was, it teaches us the characteristics God desires in a leader of his people. It highlights some of the things God values in his servants. And the thing about David, though, is that he wasn't perfect. He was, in so many ways, the fulfillment of a lot of Israel's dreams. But as often happens when you meet your heroes, he disappointed. They had this dream of someone who would be their king and lead them. And he was pretty great, but he just wasn't all that, you know. And at the end of it, David was only finite man. He teaches us that although he was a great king, he couldn't be Israel's greatest king. David at his best, he just wasn't enough. And that's the way that David points us forwards to the true and better king, who is Jesus. So remarkably, Jesus mirrored the pattern of David. What we find in David, we find it again, but better in Jesus. I want to go through these same three things I've just gone through: humble, suitable, capable, and show you how Jesus was like David, but better than David. Firstly, Jesus was humble. Philippians 2, verse 5 to 8 says, "In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross." Thank you, Jesus. We find this incredible humility in Jesus. He had the humility to be born as a man, to live an unglamorous life. He had the humility to die a humiliating death. Even today, Jesus is still humble. He wasn't humble for a time. Humility is who he is. Matthew 11, verse 29, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." That's Jesus, humble. What a great king. He doesn't lord it over us. He doesn't delight in like stomping over those who follow him. He lays himself down for us. He loves us. He rules the universe in humility and kindness. The humility we see in David is just a taste of the humility of the true and better King, Jesus. Jesus was suitable for the purposes that God put before him. Hebrews 2, verse 17 to 18. Speaking about Jesus, it says, "For this reason, he had to be made like them, fully human in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, and that he might make atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted." When we think of the one who would become the better king, the true and better David, we find certain criteria that need to be met, right? To be a suitable king for humanity, we need someone who is perfect. He had to be sinless, righteous, in control. We needed God. No human could do it. David showed us that. But we also needed a man, because if we want someone who's going to reach out and take hold of God, right? We need someone who can reach out and take hold of God. God opened the way to himself, but we need someone to show us the way from here to there. We need a shepherd from among us. We need a person, a man who can represent humanity, a human being, right? Otherwise, God could easily have sent us an angel or a chicken or I don't know. You know, we needed a human being. This is, scripture teaches us this. In the same way that humanity... I know some people who love animals very much. But we didn't need an animal. The Old Testament taught us that as well, right? The sacrifices of animals wasn't enough. We needed, it was humanity that turned away from God. And in order for humanity to turn back to God, we needed a human being. So Jesus came as a human being. He came and took humanity onto himself, becoming like us in every way, so that he could represent us to place humanity back under the kingship of God. Yes? He's fully God, fully man. This makes Jesus suitable to be our king. Fully God, fully man, fully sinless and righteous. Suitable. When we say that Jesus is worthy, right? When you use that word worthy, we mean he's suitable. He's a match. He's fit to be king. He deserves it. He's worthy. He is suitable. And like David, Jesus was also capable. He was able to live a perfect life and die a perfect death. Like David, his capability is found in his dependence on the Spirit. This is crazy. Okay, look at this, okay. So then John gave this testimony. I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one. Sometimes we grapple with Jesus' life on earth. We ask, like, how did he do it? How did he work miracles? How did he hear from God? How did he fight temptation? We understand from Scripture that Jesus was tempted as we are tempted. We understand from Scripture that he prioritized his relationship with his Father. We understand that Jesus showed us how to live as Christians. How did he do it? Sometimes we think, okay, it must have been easy because he was God, right? Surely for Jesus, the Son of God, it's easy to walk in step with God. But the amazing thing is this. When Jesus lived as a man on earth, he lived like a man. He didn't do miracles by his power as the Son of God. He didn't cheat. That's the word I'm going to use, right? Jesus wasn't like us, but with like all the cheat codes enabled. He wasn't able to just like tap in. He didn't, like he could have if he wanted to. He was still God, but he didn't. When Jesus lived as a man, he lived fully as a man. What he did on earth, Jesus did by dependence on the Holy Spirit, right? It seems like a subtle distinction. Now you say to me, oh, okay, you say it wasn't by the power of God, but it was. The Holy Spirit is God. Ha ha, got you. No, it's a subtle distinction, but the mind-blowing thing is this, right? That Jesus wasn't in a different category. He didn't play by a different rule book because he was God. He became like us in every way. He communed with his Father by the Spirit. He walked on water by the Spirit. Everything he did was in dependence on the power of God by the Spirit. He was capable the same way David was capable because the Spirit remained on him, right? And why is this mind-blowing? Because we have access to the same Spirit. We can do the same things that Jesus did, God willing, because we share in the same Spirit. That's the mind-blowing beauty of what God has done in pouring out the Spirit on all flesh, in saying that we can enter in to that same communion with the Father that Jesus had. We look at Jesus, we say, Jesus, it was so easy for you. You were God. He was God, but he wasn't playing by a different rule book. He showed us the way to the Father, a way that we can walk in because he's made it possible. He sent the Spirit, the same Spirit that remained on Jesus, dwells in you and me. Wow. The same Spirit that made David capable to be king makes us capable to live in the calling that God has given to each one of us. Yes? The life of David models much of what God loves. We can learn about who God is, who he expects us to be and to become. And we learn this principle, and this is what I want to leave you with, that God has designed many patterns on earth to communicate heavenly ideas to us. Yeah? David was a pattern, a model, a type designed to point to Jesus. So was Moses and Samson and Jonah and Joseph. The Bible's characters and stories, they were all designed by God to point to Jesus. And outside of the Bible, we have things that have been designed by God to tell us about himself, right? Marriage symbolizes Christ and the church. Sleep teaches us about rest and trusting in God. Friendship helps us to understand the companionship of the Spirit. At their best, fathers on earth help us understand the fatherhood of God. And at their worst, they make us ache and cry out for the redemption of broken families. All of these things, imperfect patterns, poor reflections, but teach your eyes to see the truth in the world around you. You learn so much about God. Psalm 19, verse 1 says, "The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands." As we go through the life of David, I want us to open our eyes to the patterns of God. We remember this about David. He was ordinary at the beginning. He stayed ordinary. It's not a story about David. It's a story about God who called David. He walked with David. And he wants to walk with us too. The band can come up. I'm going to pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the patterns that you've woven into Scripture and that you've woven into the universe to draw our eyes ultimately to our true and better King, Jesus. We thank you that the life of David illuminates Jesus for us. And we thank you, Jesus, that you are speaking to us today. That you speak, you call out by your Spirit, you whisper in our hearts, and you teach us to conform our lives to the same patterns. Like David was humble, like Jesus was humble, Father, we want to be humble too. Like David was suitable for your purposes, we want to be suitable. Come, Lord, and shape our lives and make us useful to you. We want to hone our gifts and our talents that you've given us. But most of all, like David, like Jesus, Father, we need your Holy Spirit dwelling in us, not just giving us the strength to do what you call us to do, but giving us you, relationship with the Father. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you are calling us to walk with you, to know you deeper, to know you better, to become more like Jesus as we're shaped in the patterns that you've created. We thank you, Lord. Amen. Why don't you stand? Let's worship together.
The greatness of your mercy.
Andy, thank you so much for saving us so well. It's quite incredible to hear that God does not look at the outward appearance, but he looks at the heart. I just have a sense that maybe for some, that is actually a daunting thought, that God looks into my heart. Just have a sense that God would want to say for some of us, though I look into your heart, though I know the depth of your heart, I do not condemn you. That though I look into the depth of your heart, I love you the same. And I get a sense maybe for some as you hear that God looks into your heart. There's a real deep awareness that your heart is not right with God. And God would want to say to you this morning that he stands ready to give you a new heart. That in Jesus, there is a new heart for you this morning. If you accept him as your Lord and Savior, why don't we close our eyes together? Maybe if it's that's you this morning, and there's a real sense that your heart is not right with God, there is an invitation, there is a loving invitation. Once you exchange your heart for a new heart in Jesus, maybe just a simple prayer, God, here is my heart. I receive the new heart of Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you for your promise to give us a new heart. Thank you for the promise of newness of heart. And I pray, Lord God, help us to live humbly in the reality of your saving grace that gives us a new heart, that we can live fully for you, Lord God, in trust and in surrender, with a heart that beats for you, with a heart that will never know condemnation, because there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because it is finished. He has done it all for us. It is finished. Hallelujah. Lord God, help us to walk out of those doors in freedom. Help us as we go through this week that we will be a people who live in the fullness of the freedom that Jesus won for us on the cross. Thank you, God. Amen. We've come to the end of this part of our meeting. Please hang out for a cup of coffee or tea. And just a reminder to the top gen that there is some nice soup waiting for you at 11:30. Sorry, Andy, you can't join them. Pursue. Great. Have a good week. Parents, remember to fetch your kids from Kids Rock.